Okay, so let's start from scratch again. Didn't actually need to save that. I'm going to do once again restore that image so we can start from fresh, brand new. So what we've got to do first of all, let's get the browser up. Internet Firefox. And bear in mind it's a little bit slow loading because it's effectively loading it off of an emulated USB, so it's not as if it's loading it off an emulated hard disk, which would be faster. So I'm gonna put that roughly halfway there. We'll get rid of these. We don't need these now. I'll put this onto Linux from scratch. Back to the home page. I'm going to click on Linux from scratch there. And I'm going to read online. And the current stable, and we need to go back to preparing a host system and host system requirements, which is where we left off. If I go back to the desktop, there you go, you can see that's the bit we were last on. So we're going to be doing a lot of stuff on the command prompt. So the next thing we need to do is to load up a console, which is called console in KDE with a K. I'm going to fill the other half of the screen with this console, and I'll also increase the font somewhat. Make that 84. Try and make the console at least 80 characters wide, because when we come to do the kernel, one of the menu systems there won't operate in a terminal that's got fewer than 80 characters or 80 columns. So that's why I've left mine at 84, and it's still quite a reasonable size font. I'll also increase the size of this to make that a bit easier to read. So here we are, this is where we start with the actual work to build Linux from scratch. And the first thing we've got to do is to ensure that the host is up to scratch, if it's actually got the correct packages installed and if it's got the correct versions, because early versions of some software packages aren't adequate to build Linux from scratch. And it says what versions and what packages we need here. And we can run this script here to check that. So if we click and highlight this, all of this here down to the EOF, paste that in, that's created a file called version.check.sh, and we can actually view that. And you can see there's that information there, it's actually highlighted it as well, which is nice. And we can run that script now with this command here. And you can see it's printing out each of those packages and the version that's been found on the host system. So these are the packages and the versions that the Gen 2 system has supplied us with. And all we need to do now is just to cross-reference what the system has got with what the LFS book has got, to ensure that the version we've got on the system is the same as or newer than the version that's in the Linux from scratch book. So first off, we've got bash. It needs 3.2 or later. We've got version 5.1, and it also says bin sh should be a symbolic or hard link to bash, and you can see there's a symbolic link printed up here, so that's good. Bin utils, it needs 2.1, 3.1 or newer. We've got 2.39. Bison 2.7, we've got 3.8, and also it says that a link from user bin yak, which is there, points to yak.bison, so that's okay. Core utils, we need 6.9, we've got 9.1. Diff utils, 2.8.1, we've got 3.8, so that's fine. You can see a lot of these requirements are quite old versions, which is quite good. So even if you've got a Linux version that's quite old, you've still got a good chance of having a successful build. If you do ignore these, by the way, you've got something missing or the version is old and you get a problem compiling, the chances are you're not going to get much help because you basically ignored this these requirements. They are requirements. If you ignore them, something breaks, well, basically on your own head be it. So don't ignore this part. So where do we get to? Find next. Find utils. 4.2.31, we've got 4.9. Gawk 4.01, we've got 5.2, and it says user bin awk should be linked to Gawk. User bin awk, yep, it's got a link to Gawk, that's fine. GCC and G++ should be 5.1 on newer. We've got 12.2 in both cases. Grep 2.5.1a, we've got 3.1. GZIP 1.3.12, we've got 1.12, that's fine. Kernel 3.2, we've got 6.1. M4 1.4.10, we've got 1.4.19, so that's okay. Make, and it's got to be GNU, it doesn't have to be GNU Make, but we've got 4.3, we need 4.0. Patch 2.5.4, we've got 2.7. Perl 5.8.8, we've got 5.36. Python 3.4, we've got 3.10. Sed 4.1.5, we've got 4.9. Tar 1.22, we've got 1.34. Texinfo 4.7, we've got 6.8. And lastly, Xed 5.0.0, we've got 5.4.1. And the last thing the script does there is just does a little test on the C++ compiler, and that looks to be all okay. So you can see the Gen 2 environment, well, you'd expect it to be good enough. It's only just over a week old, this release, and if you're watching this on the 1st or 2nd of March, as you've seen, the one that's on there is only a few days old as it is, so again, these versions might be the same as what I've got, or they might, one of them might be slightly newer, but obviously they're all okay. So again, it's going through in a little bit more detail again, what goes on in each individual chapter. It says these chapters run commands on the host system and restart and be certain of one thing, that procedures performed as the root. So this is when you're restarting if you take a break. But as we're on the VirtualBox, as you've seen, we can save the system state. We don't need to shut things down. We can also take snapshots at particular points that are important. So we know if we're, for example, if you're not sure about the GCC, which is the biggest package in the book, it's quite involved. You might want to take a snapshot just before that in case something goes wrong there. Chapters 5 to 6, we're going to mount the partition and create a user called LFS and use it, and then we carry on by building some more and getting into the Chroot environment. So the next thing we're going to do is create a new partition. We need to become the root, so the easiest way to do that is to do sudo su minus, and we've become the root on the live CD. This allows us to do the commands on the system. Now, always in the LFS book, they never give any specific commands for managing or creating the disks and the partitions. They could do, but if you think about it, everybody's system's different. One person's disk that they're going to use might be SDA, it might be SDK, SDD. It could be anything. Partitions could be different. So there's so many combinations. I think that's why they don't ever actually give any specific commands. Plus, it's not really to do with the LFS building itself. It's only to do with the configuration. So there's just a load of information here about what you need to create or how you might want to lay it out. There's no specifics as such. So what I'll do is I'll go through showing you what I'm going to do in the virtual environment, and then we'll catch up with creating the file systems in the book in a moment when we've actually created the partitions. So the first thing we need to do is to look to see what hard disks are on the system, and we can do that with fdisk minus L. And well, you'd expect there to be one disk, but there's actually two. The reason is we've booted off a live image, and this first loop device is the live image, which is mounted as a disk. So that's why that's there. So we'll ignore that. The hard disk that we're interested in, where we're going to build Linux from scratch, is this fella here, /dev/sda, and you can see it's called VBox hard disk, which helps us identify it. And you can see it's 32 gig, which is the size we created when we were defining the virtual machine and the virtual disk. So now we know which disk we're dealing with, we can run fdisk, and if you double click that designation there and paste it in, it's the safest way of dealing with this. Run, type it in case you mistype and you start editing the wrong disk. If you're on a live system, real system, it could be that you start modifying an existing disk that you don't really want to touch. So it's always safest to double click the designation and paste it in. So we get this little menu come up, or little message come up, and we're in the fdisk program now. And normally we do p to show us how it's configured, because it's a brand new disk, there's no information stored on it. So what we need to do is create a partition with n for new, accept the default p for primary partition, and again the default partition number 1 for the first partition. Again, the first sector we want to accept. And then we need to define how many sectors this partition is going to be. Well, I don't know how many sectors, but I do know how big I want it to be. And I want it to be, this is going to be the boots partition. So this is the partition that's going to hold the kernel and various other boot programs and configuration files. And I know that I want it to be 256 megabytes. So what I do is I put in a plus and then 256 MB. M, capital M. And what that means is I want to extend the partition by 256 megabytes. Press enter and it says it's created partition number 1. It's created a default type of Linux, and it's created it as 256 megabytes as I requested it to. The next partition I'm going to create is a swap partition. Generally, you probably won't need a swap, especially if you're just running LFS for educational purposes. It can be useful to have a swap sometimes if you're running out of memory. A small swap might be a good way of having an indication that swapping is occurring, because you may hear the disk rattling if it's an old type of disk, or you may notice the hard disk light flashing a lot if it's starting to swap. So it can be a good little warning sign. So I'm going to create a swap partition. Again, new n, accept the default of p for primary partition. Again, the default, the next one, it's picked automatically. And once more, the first sector, I'll take the default. And this time I'm going to give it a default or a size of 1 gigabyte. So plus 1 gig. And it said it's created a new partition 2 type Linux, and it's 1 gigabyte in size. Finally, we need to create a root partition, and the root partition is where the bulk of the operating system is going to be stored. So for the final time, we'll do new accept the P primary, accept the partition number 3, accept the first sector, and we want to fill the rest of the disk up now. So we'll just accept the default, which will be the last sector. And you can see it's created a partition number 3 of type Linux, size 30 gigabytes. So if we now do P to print up the partitions, you can see the three partitions there. There's one other thing we need to do, is to change the type of the swap file from Linux to swap. And to do that, we type T to change the type. The partitioning number we need is partition 2, because that's where the swap's going, so we put 2 in there. If we're not sure what the ID is for the partition, as it suggests there, we can type L to list all of them. If I just scroll back, you'll see Linux has got a type of 83, which is that one there. We actually want a Linux swap, which is type 82. And it actually lists some of the more common ones here. You can see there, you can either type in swap or type in 82. So I'll type in 82, and it says that it's changed the partition from swap to, from Linux to swap. So now if I do P, you can see the type has changed 82 and the name. Finally, we need to write those changes. W to write them, and you can see that's been altered. Okay, so we've created partitions. What we need to do next is to format them. And the suggestion here of a command to do that, we'll copy and paste that in. And what this does is format the partitions by default to ext4. The boot partition probably doesn't need to have ext4 on, although it could be useful in case of disk crash. Sometimes ext2 is more appropriate, especially if it's a smaller partition. 256 megabytes is probably big enough to have an ext4 file system on it. So I'm going to type in sda1. Again, you may want to do a copy and paste on this, so just double click that name there and paste it in, just to ensure that you are going to format the correct partition. Especially if it's on a system with other disks and partitions. So I press enter, that's formatted that partition. And I'm going to do the same now, but for the boot partition, the root partition, that was the boot partition. So this time it's going to be SDA3. And that's formatted that one. You'll notice with the other one, because it's a small partition, it's formatted, it's slightly different, using a flag called small, whereas on the bigger partition it hasn't used that flag. So it will have formatted them slightly differently. Finally, we need to format the swap partition with this command here, mkswap. So just scroll back up, grab the name of that one, and paste that in. And that's been formatted as well, as you can see, to be swap space. So we move on, and what we're going to do now is to create an LFS variable. So this is an environment variable called LFS, and it's critical to how the LFS system is built in the initial stages, and it's also critical if you're on a live system to get this right. If you don't get it right, you could actually break your live running system, especially some of the commands either overwrite or delete file system, programs as the root command, as the root user. So it is absolutely critical that you get this right. You'll notice me check it every now and then, and I advise you to check it. If you're going to put a command in and you've got the slightest doubt that LFS is set, then check it prior to running the command. So what we're going to do is to copy this command in and create the environment variable with this export command. What this does, it creates the variable name LFS and it'll have the contents of MNT LFS. And this is the mount point where we're going to mount the disk partitions that we've just created. And to check that that's actually created correctly, this is the command you run to check that it's got something in it. And you can see that LFS has indeed got MNT LFS inside. It says one way to ensure that it's always set is to edit the bash profile in root and the home directory. As we've got a live GUI here, it's a temporary system, and we're also using the VirtualBox where we're saving snapshots and we're saving the image when we shut it down. That's probably not that necessary, but it's something you might want to consider if you are on a real machine that you can boot and shut down every day. So now we're going to mount the partition. First of all, we need to create a place where this partition can live. So we've specified where we want it. If we do ls-l $LFS, you can see that doesn't exist at the moment. But by running this command here, we can make that directory. And you can see now it exists. We're not getting an error. And then this next command here is the command to mount it. We want to mount the root directory. So if you remember previously, if I scroll back, the root partition is devsda3. So that's what we type in here. And it says if you're using multiple partitions, mount them like this. So we also need to create a place for the boot directory, boot partition to go. So we create a boot directory as well. And because we've already mounted the root partition, this boot directory creating is actually being created on that root partition and not on the live CD partition. So we've created that directory. We can now rerun this mount command, but with SDA1 for the root, and we mount it, for the boot, we mount it at the LFS boot that we've just created here. So now if I do df-h, you can see we've got our LFS partition which we created, which is just under 30 gigabytes available. It was 32, the whole disk. It's actually 31 with the boot and the swap that's been taken off of it. And we've also mounted the boot on top of that root partition. And you can see it's just under 250 meg. After it's been formatted. It says here, the warning, the above instructions assume you're not restarting your computer. You can safely assume that I won't be restarting the virtual machine. I'll just be saving the image as it is and doing snapshots as we go through. If you're using a swap partition, can use this command to enable the swap. So our swap was devsda2, if you remember. So we've activated that. You can see the minus V option has given all these bits of information here to show that it's been mounted and activated. And you can actually run swap on by itself to show that it is actually active. So that's all there is to preparing the host system in terms of the disk. We've now got a disk for Linux from scratch. We've partitioned it, we've formatted the file system, and we've mounted those partitions, and they're active in the current running live CD. So this may be a point we want to take a snapshot. So we can do that by bringing the cursor down to the bottom, clicking the X button. As I say, I'm going to save machine state. I'm never going to shut it down. The only time I'll shut it down is at the end when we finish Linux from scratch and we want to boot it for the first time. But for convenience, I'm just going to keep on saving the machine state. Save a lot of effort in between sessions. Okay, that's done. Let's get the VirtualBox manager up again. And I'm going to right click this and take another snapshot, and I'll put hard disks prepared, or hard disk prepared, there's only one. And I might want to put some information, for example, dev SDA1 is the boot partition, dev SDA2 is the swap, and slash dev SDA3 is the root partition, just for information. Click OK, and you can see I've now got another snapshot taken, which is later than the previous one. Which is later than the previous one. So we could, if we wanted to, go right back. Right back and restore the initial one. And boot that. And you can see we're right back to the bare live CD as we booted it initially. And we could start all over again if we'd done something wrong or wants to do something differently, for example. So I'm going to just keep it saved. It'll be simpler. If I start messing around with that option, I'll probably forget that I've changed it. So what I want to do now is to actually put this back to this point where we've created the hard disk and restart the VM. And you can see we're back to where we were just a few minutes ago, where we'd created the swap partition and mounted it.